everyone. I'm here to talk about a project called Southeast by Southeast, which is a community refugee space in South Philadelphia. To backtrack a minute, when I went to school for painting, I got an MFA in painting. And afterwards, I had a friend who was working for the City of Philadelphia Mural Arts Program, and she asked if I wanted to work on a mural project. I said yes. And the project was located at 6th and Master in North Philadelphia. And I felt the process of creating the mural was one in which you learn so much about a community. You learn about a community's history, dreams, and aspirations. Subsequently, I've worked on about 30 murals through the Mural Arts Program since then. And with each project, you really learn in depth about a neighborhood and its aspirations. In 2011, Jane Golden, the director of the Mural Arts Program, asked if I wanted to work on a new project with refugee communities from Burma and Bhutan. I said, yes, I really want to do this. And then I also said, oh my God, I need a map. I don't know where Bhutan is. And I need to learn about these new communities. So I got a map and I learned that families from Nepal, Bhutanese refugees were families from Nepal who had moved to Bhutan in the 1600s for farming. They'd lived there for many years, but they'd still kept their Nepali identity, religion, and culture intact. In the 1990s, the king of Bhutan tried to get rid of any other ethnic group. So villages were burned, you weren't allowed to practice your religion, you weren't allowed to speak your language. So these families fled back to Nepal, weren't allowed to be repatriated, and they lived in refugee camps for about 20 years. I also learned, refugees from Burma had basically been in civil wars with the Burmese government for the past 60 years. These ethnic minorities were persecuted. So then, they are ultimately repatriated. Both groups were repatriated in South Philadelphia. Both groups came from agrarian rural backgrounds and were basically dropped off in these neighborhoods, which were facing their own problems of violence and crime. So you can imagine the kind of adjustment issues that these families face. Language, cultural adjustment, so many issues around adjustment. So what should a public art project do around these kinds of issues? What could it do? So I thought maybe not a mural to begin with. And I then began to do research. I met Melissa Fogg, who is a social worker, and she introduced me to many families. I learned about a photography project where doctors from Jefferson gave out cameras to new refugees and learned about barriers to health. I began to learn about, the major issues. Learning the language was really, really difficult, but also began to see how much pride and what refugee families brought with them. So could you do a project that was able to help fill in certain gaps in terms of language and a cultural adjustment, and at the same time, celebrate assets that refugee families come with? Culture, tradition, resilience, and community collaboration. And I began really listening to the community. So I thought, also, what does it mean to be a refugee? It means that you are persecuted. It means that you don't have a safe place. It's the opposite of having a home. So I thought, well, what if we could create some sort of safe haven? And what if this could be a place where communities could help co-create what would happen in this space, whether it be learning or otherwise? So I proposed the idea of a storefront and went around South Philadelphia, called many numbers, and found a storefront located at 7th and Dudley, which is close to where many of the families live. And we began to hold workshops based on trial and error. So thinking, what would bring families in? What would be interesting? Also, who are the artists within these refugee communities? How could they become the teachers instead of Americans always being the teachers? So, but yet at the same time, there was this huge language barrier. So the social worker, Melissa Fogg, began to pull in volunteers for ESL classes and other sorts of cultural adjustment. And I began to create these monthly events. We had everything from Nepali lunch to and craft sales. So that was the Nepali lunch. It was a huge hit. It was absolutely delicious. To Bollywood versus breakdance. So thinking about all of the ways that culture can be this great source of both pride, social networking, and collaboration. We held sewing classes, and really what we did was we tried to listen to the community itself and ask, what do you want? What do you come with? What can you build? We also had events such as the photograph over here, which was a women's photo show. So we gave out cameras to refugee women and we asked, what is hardest for you about life in the US? What traditions from home do you keep here? Do you feel you have a sense of freedom in the home and outside of the home? If you could read this photograph, it says, in Bhutan and Nepal, I used to play the mouth piano. When I'm looking for my cow in the jungle, it would make a good sound and the cow would come. So it just tells you, like, this is someone who's coming from a completely different place and space, and actually in 3 months, you are, as a refugee, you're supposed to completely be functioning here. You're supposed to have a job, pay rent, learn the language, these impossible tasks. But again, back to the kind of assets that refugee families come with. I found this incredible weaver from Burma and found that in Burma, each ethnic group has their own distinct weaving traditions. And this is Ma Kesa. She is a Karen weaver. And you can see this is her loom. And this is Karen clothing. And it's a huge source of pride. And I thought, wow, sometimes people travel the world to go to other countries, they, you know, buy things. Like here in Philadelphia, we have rich cultural heritages that are alive and well. And so she has been someone who has really been with this program for the past 5 years. She comes to every class, English class, citizenship class. She knows all 100 questions that I don't know if many Americans could answer. And also still really holds fast to her traditions. Here's another example of Karen clothing. And you can see the kind of pride in the clothing. Another example. So when we had craft sales, people actually came out. Since the beginning in 2011 to now, we've had multiple craft sales and interest has been building. At our last craft sale, Karen, Chin, and Nepali, and also now Mexican women know about this space and came to the sale. Over $3,000 worth of items were sold. And this is coming from a group of people that are placed in really menial jobs like meatpacking factories, barely earning minimum wage, and yet you see how much potential there is for other opportunities for communities. Building on that, there were a set of designers named Senpei and Kohai. They purchased some of the fabric, Karen fabric, and created these incredible hybrid designs. So you can see this vest is combining new and old. Along with monthly events and daily events happening at this space, I began to work with teens on a book. And this was another project. So thinking also another cultural asset actually is your stories that you come with. I was so struck by the stories of teens in this interview. Tells you about a family walking, but you know, from Burma to Malaysia. and the kind of grit and endurance and resilience and desire, real desire for a better life that comes through. And every teen who I've talked to and interviewed, I find this again and again. So this was also another interpretation, another kind of activity, which also describes the story of her family, this girl's family, getting to a refugee camp in Thailand after being in the jungle in Burma for many years. And again, this drive for a better life, for school. This was a photograph which was part of the teen photo book. A lot of pride in who you are, your traditions, your identity. And Karen Youth Life, Karen Plus Education, you can see these themes repeat. Okay, this was the Karen, a series of Karen alphabet cards. So, can you come to the United States, learn English, pay taxes, be a great citizen, and still keep your language and traditions? Yes. this is the photo of the woman who I mentioned before, Makesa, coming from the refugee camp. Immediately when you get to the camp, a photograph is taken of your family, and this really picture really sticks with me. So along with the storefront space, which we've had for 5 years, monthly events, weekly and daily programming, we also have done murals. I've done about 8 murals just with this project. And the murals now serve as a way to tell a collective story. So this mural is called Language Lab, and it celebrates the over 30 languages spoken in South Philadelphia. You can wait for the 47 bus and learn a new word. So what happens now at Southeast by Southeast? Again, on a daily basis, we have ESL, citizenship, grandparents groups, women's groups, a refugee women's textile initiative. We have monthly programming with shows. We have larger public art projects. I am still working with teens on a second book and reaching a wider range of from the refugee community, Eritrea, Iraq, and Syria. This is an ESL class. I think one huge takeaway is that refugee communities have so much to offer. They can teach us. At the same time, there are needs that communities have, and how can this be more of an exchange? Every time I've gone to Southeast by Southeast, I felt I've learned from communities that are there. And the network of volunteers and teachers that work there, I know they feel the same. We hope to continue this storefront space and possibly move on to other spaces around the city. Some of the bigger questions to take away are, how can cities provide welcoming spaces for new communities that come in? How can we provide opportunities for these new communities to thrive? Because given just a little bit of space and a little bit of time and some volunteers, we found that all the ingredients are there. They just need the time, the space to grow. Thank you so much.